Hi everyone, and welcome back to another exam unboxing video. Today I'm going to be talking about an exam which I would consider to be extremely difficult. If you were going to rank exams on a tier list, this one would be right near the top. So this is the Putnam competition, which is a math competition, a math exam for American undergrad students. And as a way to demonstrate its, difficulty, you can look at what the scores usually are. So this exam, even though it has 12 questions in total, each worth 10 points, so that's a total of 120 points, the median score is usually between 0 and 1. And that's despite the fact that students who sit this exam are usually specializing in mathematics. So that means at least half of the students often get 0 marks on this exam. So that indicates how hard it is. And I'll show you the questions in a second, but first, just a little bit more context. This exam was, you could say, founded in 1927 in memory of William Lowell Putnam by his wife Elizabeth, and I guess it's gone on to challenge and maybe haunt undergrad students ever since then. They give out cash prizes to the top students, ranging from $250 to $2,500, and if you're one of the top 5 students, then you can be named a Putnam Fellow and you might get a scholarship to a prestigious university like Harvard, or you might get poached by a company looking for very talented students, because the names of the top performing students are published as well as mailed out to all the participating universities. Sometimes these top performing students go on to achieve great things in math and science. Of the previous Putnam Fellows, 2 of them have gone on to win a Nobel Prize in Physics, including Richard Feynman, and 3 of them have gone on to win a Fields Medal in Mathematics. In 2018, the top 3 performing teams were from Harvard, MIT, and UCLA. So let's have a little look at the questions they had to solve last year. So this is the entire exam here. Now, if you want your own copy to follow along with, there'll be a link in the description where you can download this exam. But let's first zoom in a little and take a closer look. Now, you might first notice we've got questions A1 to A6 in this first column, and then we've got B1 to B6 down here. So when you're sitting this exam, you actually get 2 3-hour sessions to work on it with a lunch break in between. So I guess you'll be working on all the A questions and then doing the B questions after lunch. Now that makes it seem like you'll have a lot of time to work on this exam, but in reality I think it's so difficult that even if you can answer 1 or maybe half a question for each session, you'll actually still be doing okay. So each question is worth 10 points, and of course you'd get 10 if you have a full and complete solution with the correct proof, although you could get 9 points for a proof that's nearly there, and 1 point for the beginnings of the correct solution that are on the right track. Of course you'd get 0 for any working that's kind of on the wrong track. And also, this exam is really about trying to prove the statements you're making. And even if you say get the right answer, if the proof that you're trying to use to show it is incorrect, then you're not going to be getting any points for that. Fully solving just 2 questions correctly should get you a halfway decent mark, and in the past a score of around 40 was enough to get into the top percentile. From what I can see online, there have only been 4 perfect scores in the history of the competition. These problems cover all kinds of undergraduate mathematics. They cover things like group theory, set theory, graph theory, number theory, all the theories of mathematics. So the concept should be no higher than undergrad, but the way that they're applied is very clever, and often the solutions to some of the later problems, they're kind of things you would never think of trying. So very clever questions based on some of the concepts that math majors, I guess, would be learning about. People that would do well in this competition are probably people with experience doing math competitions. Maybe that is the International Math Olympiad, which you might participate in high school.
It's not necessarily just going to be the top student in math class who would ace this, but rather someone who understands sort of the tricks of competition math and what it means to write a proof in a short span of time that whoever is marking the exam is able to understand and follow, and it seems quite complete. I think it is at best a tangential skill set to, I guess, actual mathematics research or being a great mathematician. I know I said that some people who have done really well on this exam have gone on to win the Fields Medal, but that doesn't mean that everyone who does well on this exam will be a great researcher, and it certainly doesn't mean that if you don't do well at this, you've got no future in math. I think it really does cater to people with competition experience or that really enjoy these sort of high pressure environments of solving math throughout an exam situation. Now, I do have a copy of some solutions here, and again, in the description, there'll be a link to the source of these solutions. They're not the official solutions, but they go some way towards showing you what an answer to a problem here would look like. Now, of course, if you're studying for this exam yourself and trying to work through the problems, you should take a bit of time to try and solve things yourself before looking at the solution. But for the sake of this video, we'll have a little bit of a flick through. So just perusing the solutions, we can, I guess, see some of the types of math that come into the solutions, how dense some of these sort of proofs are that you're working on. Our solutions use skills from analysis, from geometry even, we've got matrices and linear algebra going on here. We've got some trig identities even coming in. Definitely we've got some complex numbers I can see. And some really, really heavy math notation and kind of intense things going on. It's very intimidating, I would say, this exam. From what I've seen online about the exam, there are a number of kind of tricks that come into a few of the problems, and understanding these concepts could make the problems look a little less intimidating for you. So I've got the pigeonhole principle, the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality for real numbers, and the AMGM inequality. So as a math student who's done maybe some analysis, you might have heard of some of these principles. To just state the first one in simple terms, according to Wikipedia, the pigeonhole principle states that if n items are put into m containers, with n being bigger than m, then at least one container must contain more than one item. It seems actually incredibly obvious. They're just, saying if you've got 10 pigeons that you want to put into 9 holes, one of those holes has to have more than one pigeon in it. Many things in math are like this, they seem obvious, but to have a principle and a way to apply this to numbers in general or to use it as part of a proof can make some of these problems apparently a little easier for you. So let's try and comprehend the solution to one of these problems. I'm going to work through A1, but actually what I'm going to do, because it's a lot neater, is to step you through what the solutions here say about A1. So let's have a read of it. It's asking us to find all ordered pairs A and B of positive integers for which this is true, that 1 over a plus 1 over b is equal to 3 over 2018. I'm choosing this problem to do because it should be the easiest. They should get progressively harder as we go down this column. So we've got our best chance of trying to understand this one here. Now, the first step in the solutions is actually taking the form of our initial formula equation and rewriting it in a factorized way. Now, I have checked this. It is just taking a lot of algebraic manipulation to get from this form to this one. It's slightly non-intuitive to even think of doing it this way. Along the way, you needed to add on a factor of 2018 squared to both sides. You had to multiply everything by -3, but you'd eventually get to this form here, and that is actually pretty great. Going on from there, The solution tells us about the fact that each of the factors, so these groups of brackets, is congruent to 1 mod 3. Now, this language means that if you do the number mod 3, I guess you'll get a value of 1. So it's kind of like if you were dividing it by 3, you'd have a remainder of 1. So the value, so the number 4 mod 3, well, 3 goes into 4 once, and then there's 1 left over, so 4 would be congruent to 1 mod 3. So would 7, because 3 goes into it twice to give you 6, and then there's 1 left over. So would 2018 squared, that's also the same. Also, minus 2018 would be congruent to 1 mod 3. That's because 3 would go evenly into minus 2019, but in this case we're one value more than that, so we're going to have 1 left over. Hope that kind of makes sense, but that's what that language means. So because these two factors have this property, I guess, we also want that same property in the factors on the right-hand side if we were to find the factors of this 2018 squared. So there are 6 positive factors of 2018 squared that are congruent to 1 mod 3. And they are 1, 2 squared, so 4, what I mentioned before, 1009, 4 times 1009, and that is, and that makes sense because both of those individually follow the property. And then we've got 4 times 1009 squared. So these are the 6 factors which I guess have the property that we like. So that would lead to the 6 possible pairs for A and B, the first one being an A value of 673 and a B value of 1358114. I hope you're allowed a calculator to help you with that, but I'm not sure. And then there's a little statement here as for negative factors. The ones that are congruent to 1 mod 3 are minus 2 times 1009, minus 2 times 1009 squared. However, all of these lead to pairs where A or B are less than 0, and the question stated that we wanted positive integers for A and B, so they are ruled out. So actually that is, I guess, our solution there. I don't know if it's necessarily the best proof or just one way of finding the pairs, because even though, like we've spoken about, this property of congruence and the modulus, it's not totally clear to me that because these factors follow that property that, you know, these factors would have to as well. Maybe it makes sense, but I don't really see much of a proof of that. But at least that's an example of probably what is the smallest solution in this answer book. The next question after this is for A2. Like, we might as well read it. So let S1, S2, all the way up to S2 to the n minus 1 be the non-empty subsets of 1, 2, all the way up to n in some order. And let M be the 2 to the n minus 1 times 2 to the n minus 1 matrix, whose ij entry is this. So calculate the determinant of this matrix M. Now, this question here has a bit more of a long solution. I don't know, it's statements about determinants in general, looking at all the indices. You can even see like one of the matrices here, and it continues all the way on to this matrix too and doesn't stop until there. So yeah, I'm not even really going to try to walk through every step of that because it will probably take us a long while. I guess technically if you follow the rule that they should increase in difficulty as you go along, this one B6 should be the most difficult question. It actually looks suspiciously similar to A1 in the sense that they love using 2018 as a number, I guess because this is the 2018 exam. You know, we're being asked, let S be the set of sequences of length 2018 whose terms are in the set 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 10 and sum to 3, 8, 6, 0. Prove that the cardinality of S is at most this here. Well, I might be able to flounder around for a while, but probably wouldn't get anywhere. If we take a look at the solution for 6, we can just look through it there. So hopefully maybe something in there could make sense to you. We've got it continuing on to the last page as well. Got some remarks, and we've even got an example. Of course, you can't use code in the exam, but some of these questions, you know, they're very difficult math questions, but if you were able to write some scripts, do some coding, you could actually probably solve them a lot easier. So I think in some sense they turn into medium problems in terms of computer science, but very difficult when you're just there trying to prove them with math. So I hope that was kind of insightful for you. As usual with these exam videos I do, I don't want anyone to be too scared off or depressed just by looking at some of these random questions and solutions, because of course if you're not in a class that's teaching these, or you're not actively preparing for and studying for this exam, then of course I don't think you're going to do very well. Like, you need to do some very targeted study at these questions. Otherwise, a lot of the terms and just the way they're done will be foreign to you. If you have participated in this exam yourself before, let us know in the comments how you found it and what your opinion of it is, because that would be a nice insider's perspective. And a huge congratulations if anyone who's watching this happened to score more than 0 points, because yeah, it's certainly very difficult. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.